turn it up.
Get ready.
You're tuned in to VO Buzz Weekly.
The show where aspiring voice actors,
established VO pros,
and curious fans alike get to meet and learn.
From the mega successful talent in voiceover, hear their personal stories, find out how they became so successful,
learn their secrets, and join them at the top.
Get seriously buzzed with your hosts, Chuck Duran and Stacey J. Aswan.
Hey everybody, I'm Stacey J.
And I'm Chuck Duran.
Here we go with a brand new episode of VO Buzz Weekly. We're glad you're with us.
Yeah, absolutely. Welcome. And hey, we have Nika Futterman on the show today. Animation, video games, and she's also awesome. That's what she does for
she's
a living. She's awesome for a living, which
she
is hard to do.
Well, not for her. It's effortless.
It's going to be a great show.
But before we go to Nika, I want to just tell you guys about something very cool. Debbie Derryberry, who you know, who's been on the show, she was with us in our first year and at the 200th. She's wonderful. She has written a book called Voiceover 101, How to Succeed as a Voice Actor.
Beautiful.
And it's a great resource for anyone, especially getting started, even for working pros. She breaks it down from mic etiquette, studio etiquette, what to wear, what not to wear, business.
Wow.
Business tips and working with copy. It's wonderful. So you can get it on Create a Space. And the link you'll see is right there. It's a paperback. It's $14.95. What a bargain.
Hello.
You can also get the Kindle and the paperback version on Amazon. And if you're near a bookstore with a Samuel French in New York or LA,
walk in and grab it.
Exactly. I love bookstores. What a novelty, right?
I always say it's much better to get your information from somebody who's been in the business than somebody who tried to get into the business and couldn't make it, so they wrote a book about being in the business. So this is the source.
It is a source. And check this out. Debbie is being very generous. She is going to give away 4 autographed copies of her book. So here's how we're going to do this. Ready?
Wow.
It's very simple. Pay attention. You're going to go to our YouTube channel, the VO Buzz Weekly YouTube channel. You hit subscribe. Then you go to Debbie's episodes 28 and 29. Watch them, like them, and leave a comment. And then four people will randomly be selected. We'll notify you privately on YouTube. And then Debbie will personalize the book however you would like and mail it to you. Okay? So do that this week. We're not going to let this go on for weeks and weeks. So do that this week. And I hope you win. And if not, buy it. Support her.
Absolutely.
And it's going to be part of your library.
Best
that you're
15 bucks you'll ever spend. So there you go.
Yeah. Okay.
And now,
Nika
let's talk
Futterman.
To Nika.
With us is an award-winning voice actor whose work, amazing work, is loved in Star Wars, The Clone Wars, Fanboy and Chum Chum, The Loud House, Sonic Boom, just to name a few. And hello, she is also a professional poker player.
Hello.
Thank you very much. We are so excited to get buzzed with this truly divine, Nika Futterman.
Oh, thank you.
Yay, can I clap?
Thank
I can
you.
Clap, right?
Hello. Listen, I just have to say.
Yeah.
That there are so many people literally around the world going, freaking finally, you guys.
Totally.
You've been on our beautiful, I always call it like the Santa Claus wish list. And so many people have said, hello, where's Nika? And so we're like, it's coming, we're gonna get, anyway. So.
That's so sweet.
I'm so glad that you're here.
I hide all the time too.
I know you're
hiding. She's a hider, all right.
I know, but it was actually, we kind of put this together pretty quickly.
Yeah, you know, we did.
I
made a promise to myself. I was like, you know what? I need to do this occasionally, especially with lovely people like you.
Well, thank you for picking us.
Because, you know, I don't know. I get shy about this stuff, too. And I'm not, like, great at talking about myself.
Yeah, well, neither is Billy West, but he does it anyhow.
Yeah. He does it.
And he does it really well.
He does it really well.
Well, let's just talk about Billy then.
It's so funny. Yeah, no, seriously speaking, when we had Billy on the show, he's like, you know, I'm a little shy. I don't really like talking about myself. He does our show. Next thing we know, he has his own podcast. Okay, now he can't stop talking. So.
Well, no, but we first saw you. Yeah. In person. I mean, obviously, we've known about you for a long time, but it was at the I Know That Voice.
Oh yeah.
Premiere.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, of course, you're in that. It's John DiMaggio's documentary. Yeah. If you don't know about it, if you haven't seen it, go to iTunes, get it. It's amazing. Nika's in it.
Absolutely.
Yeah. But I remember, and 2 months later, we premiered our show.
Yeah.
And so it was literally like, I'm like, Chuck, it's going to happen. So I always feel like people get here when they're supposed to. So
totally.
Absolutely.
First of all, it's so fabulous what you are wearing. Please,
thank you.
What is the story behind this?
Is that custom made?
No, it's not custom made, and I thought it was the coolest thing. I'm messing up my microphone here. But see, you see all these fun things.
Wow.
Here, wait, stand over here and look into that camera, because you can see. And you have to twirl. That is a twirl. I might borrow that from you.
Yeah, baby. This is the weirdest thing.
It's so cute.
Like, I found this online. I'm kind of an online hoe.
There's
a family.
You can't say ho on our show.
Oh, right. Wait.
I was going to say, this is Chuck calling the pedal black here.
So I found this like online thing, and it's called Style We.
Okay.
And it's like I think it's a company out of Korea. And it's like all these designers who can't, you know, I mean, part of the thing about designing is that it's hard to have the money to get your stuff out there.
Right.
So it's this company that like, you know, has designers and they, I guess, give their design ideas and they go, hey, yeah, we'll make it for you. And this was one of the...
It is so fantastic.
And I got, you know, it's like I got it last year or something like that. And I thought, this is perfect.
It is. Look, you could voice a mushroom.
Yeah,
you
totally.
Can voice a
and
robot.
Everyone's like, are these real characters? And I'm like, I don't think any of them are like real characters. They just seem like they're some real...
So
they,
fantastic.
Yeah, they made copies
that
of real characters.
That kind of looks like your little guy, Adam.
Yeah, yeah,
right?
Kind of.
A little bit.
Except that he is... Well, red hair. Yeah.
There's Kung Fu
Pandorino?
Pandorino.
You know, there's a panda.
I love it.
So I was like,
and
yeah, this would be perfect.
Bird.
This is like
perfect.
Tony the Tiger.
Yeah. What he said.
All right. We're going to head down to some nitty gritty. We're going to ask you some questions. How about that?
Okay.
You ready?
I hope so.
Why don't you take us all back? A lot of people out there would be or are dying to know.
Yeah.
Take us back to, you know, you have a background in singing and obviously, you know, your acting career. How did that all begin and how did that all lead you into voiceover?
Well, it's funny because I think that some people, you know, who are singers and actors and stuff, that is what sort of like leads them. And it is what led me into voiceover. But like back when I was a singer or wanting to be a rock star when I was, you know, younger, it was because I grew up, my dad was a music producer. So I wanted so badly to like do that for my life.
Yeah.
And, one of the things, so I sort of had that in my sights about, you know, what my life was going to be like. I was going to, you know, be a rock star or something like that. And I also, you know, was obsessed with being an actor. But there was a little problem, and that was that I didn't want to be famous.
She didn't want to be famous.
So you're saying off key? No.
Yeah, so I think off key. No, but I was like, I wanted all the things that came with being able to do all that stuff, but without people knowing
without the fame. Mm.
But I didn't know about voiceover.
Right.
So I just kept, I was on this sort of path, this trajectory where I thought I was going to do that. So I moved out to Los Angeles and I was doing television on camera stuff. And I had this manager and she said, hey, you should do voiceover. And I was like, what's that? What is that?
Can I be not famous?
Yeah. I was like, I'm not really, and she's like, you know, like cartoon voices and stuff. And I was like, someone would pay me to do that? Because I do it anyway.
A lot of dough, too.
Yeah, great dough. I didn't know that at the time. I just was like, yeah, that sounds really great. And then I went on an audition like the next week for Hey Arnold, a part in Hey Arnold. So this is back, you know, in the 90s.
Yeah.
And I got the part. So I think at the time I had some like heat on me because I was doing TV and stuff and I thought I was funny and everything. So I was like, you know, ready to just take on anything.
Yeah.
And so I went and I got this part. And then the next week, I didn't even have a voiceover agent at the time. The next week, I got a great agent. And then all of a sudden, I was doing all these voiceover auditions and doing all these great shows with amazing people like Billy and like all the like people who were the best of the best. And I was like, this is amazing. It's all the awesome stuff.
Yeah, and, but you didn't know that going in. You didn't know that you were working with like these freaking insane ladies.
No, I didn't know. I was just like, who are these wonderfully nice, incredibly talented, funny, amazing people? And I was like, this is where I belong.
There you go.
This is what I'm into. Not all the stuff.
Right.
And so little by little, I think I was doing it for like 6 years when I decided I wanted to quit everything else. And the cool thing was that I quit everything else when I was kind of doing well in them. Right. So I never had that like really crappy feeling that you get when you're an actor a lot of the time.
Right, right.
I got to like not have to experience that. And then I just started 100% focusing on, you know, doing this thing that was so much fun and just was all the things that I loved and nobody knew who I was.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So besides that, besides, you know, doing this cool thing and having nobody know who you are, compared to the other stuff that you were doing on camera, acting or even singing, like what do you think is some of the best ingredients of voiceover that really, really drew you to it?
Or even today, right now. Like I, as you're probably going to tell, the more you talk to me and like when people are going to see me, I'm Cameron. And I'm like,
but
I'm just like,
a blue square over your face.
Oh, thank you. A bag over my head. I mean, like, I'm freaky. You know what I mean? Yeah. So one of the things I remember having always to, was like, what are you doing with your mouth and your face and your all those things? Like, I was just an animated person. So this is great. Nobody sees me, so I can be as animated as I want.
Right.
And it really worked. And so everybody else, everyone else I was working with was like the same freaky kind of person.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And I was like, right? You know?
Yeah. Right.
And really, it's like, we're a bunch of freaks and geeks and like people that just wanna really have a lot of fun. And I mean, it's definitely a different vibe now than it was back, you know, 20 something years ago. Cause then it really truly was just like freaks and geeks and, you know, mostly people that like weren't trying to be too cool and you could just like go in and there was a lot of love going on. And I still think there is. Because, you know.
Oh, yeah, there definitely
there is.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's definitely sort of transitioned a little bit more into Hollywood.
Yeah, for sure.
And, you know, and now with everything with social media and everything, it's like, you know, now like the pressure of like that stuff, which is the reason why I hid in the first place, is starting to happen. And
like
so,
being on shows like this?
Being on shows like this and like, yes and no. I mean, this stuff is like just because you want to like, you know, talk about how, I mean, I like, for me, this is
this
like, I want to talk.
We have more viewers than American Idol.
Hey!
So, this is like the top of the top.
Okay, but this is still about like connecting.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And with you guys and with the audience and like just about the love and the appreciation of being able to do this for
a
living.
You're right.
Where, you know, social media, and I'm not knocking it because it is the reality of life now.
Right.
That's about going like, how many followers can I get? And like the on different shows that I'm on now, they ask that we take part in that, and that's something that I've been avoiding. So now all of a sudden I'm
it's
like,
a different kind of stardom,
right?
And yeah, but you know, you are doing Twitter.
I just started doing the last month, like the last three weeks.
I'm proud of you.
But it's like literally probably been like the last 3 weeks to a month where I'm like, okay, but and I'm like, wait a second, but I'm just not that in. I'm not that fascinating. Where, you know, there are some people who are really, really into it. And they were saying to me years ago, you got to do this. You got to do this. And they have like, you know, 60,000 followers because they are on top of it. Mm-hmm. For me, I'm like, and you know what? It's very interesting because I am finding as I'm doing it, because I feel now that sort of that I have to, is that it really is sort of like a beautiful thing in a way. I don't really enjoy like talking about myself that much, but I do enjoy connecting with people that are so so appreciative. And I just go, wow, this is so beautiful. And for kids out there who are, this is like kind of like with their life, because that's what like a lot of young people now, it's like, you know.
Well, Because you guys mm-hmm. in this business, animation, video games,
yeah.
you guys go to cons
yeah.
and you visit with these geeks that yeah. normally are picked on in school.
Right.
And you guys treat mm-hmm. them like heroes and they freaking go out of their mind. And that's the most beautiful thing I've right. ever seen. I just went to a right. big con a few yeah. weeks ago and I saw this with my own eyes and I literally almost like cried.
Yeah.
Because you guys are so amazing with yeah. these people. Love
well, and
that.
Especially when really you do cool. your Star Wars events and you bring yes. people from the audience to actually do yeah. scenes with you and James Arnold Taylor and Ashley.
And James, and those guys are, they're so yeah. good at this yeah. stuff. Yeah. And they're so yeah. wonderful and such amazing
but that means
people.
The world
and they
those
love
kids
it.
That come up with you.
Right.
I mean, that could be a life changing totally. Moment that you maybe aren't even aware of at the time.
I know, 100%. Yeah. And that's why, because I haven't really done that many cons. I've been avoiding them the same way because I get. Like shy or I feel weird right. about talking about myself or I feel weird about like, you know, I just felt weird for whatever yeah. reason. And I just got asked to do one in a few months and I was like, you know what? Yeah.
That's right.
I'm gonna do this yeah. because of that.
Yeah.
Because of the connection. That. And yeah. it's just. It's I'm all about the love.
I know, that's cool. And yeah. the thing is that all you guys are yeah. all about the love, which is what yeah. makes it really, right. really cool
yeah.
for everybody.
Yeah.
Yeah. yeah.
It's wonderful. Well, I have to ask you.
Uh-oh.
How...
She has
well,
to.
Well, first of all, I'm glad yeah. that you are putting yourself out there more so that you can actually feel the appreciation of mm. the incredible work you've done and you're doing.
Thank you.
Because I think it's great because that's going to feed you. And
yeah.
it's going to mean so much to the people that really love you. How did the whole... professional poker thing come into play.
Yeah.
See, now this I love right? talking about. Because it's like one step removed from myself in a weird way.
Yeah.
Well, like, so I love what I do. I have the best job in the world. We've been talking about
yes.
that. But probably, and I've been doing it a long time. And I think a few years ago, I guess you would call it a midlife crisis. I was like, I want something else in my life and I don't know what it is because I love my job, so it's not like I feel like I'm missing anything, but I feel like there's something. And I had been playing poker for fun. Mm-hmm. And you know, I was obsessed with it, but I never in a million years thought, okay, you know what, I'm gonna do this full time. I thought that's kind of a crazy dream, especially because yeah. I didn't find it in my 20s. I was like, if I had found it in my 20s, it'd be one thing, but it's like now later on in life, and basically I'm like, not only am I considered sort of like a middle-aged woman in the poker world, but I'm also a chick. So
they have like demographics in poker?
Well, like you there's have to like be a 3% age? Of poker players
oh
are women.
Oh gosh, there is like ageism everywhere.
Oh wow. Yeah, there's it's an interesting thing. It's not so much that I think that it happens to be that there are very few women poker players.
Right.
And a lot of the poker players now are, you know, younger because now it's sort of getting as popular as, you know, other sports.
Yeah.
That's about as sporty as I get.
Stretch first.
So I just was like, you know what? I thought about all these other things I want to do. Do I want to start a clothing line? Do I want to open a business? Do I want to do all it? And I was like, do I want to get back into on-camera acting? Ah! You know, like I thought about all those things. I keep spinning. But I kept going, wait, what I would tell any person if I was giving advice to them is do what you love. Follow your bliss.
Yeah.
And so I was like, I want to be a poker player. And so that's what happened. That's what I did. I was like,
so
I'm going to play.
How does one do that? Do you
so
start?
I played poker tournaments, right? So you okay. can play cash poker where you just keep paying money and you just sit at a table and when you make some money, you get
yeah.
up, or if you lose all your money, you get up. Poker, like a lot of gamers are into poker. Because poker tournaments it's a strategy game. You basically all get, you pay a certain amount of money, you all get the same amount of chips, and you sit there and you try to knock everybody out.
Yeah.
So it's funny, because I play with a lot of gamers, and I play with a lot of chess players, and that's what poker is, except that you can actually make money doing it.
Right.
And you can make big money doing it. And
have you won some big money?
Yeah, I've won some big money.
She has.
I've won some big money, and... I haven't won the kind of big money that I'm hoping to win.
Do you have to be a good liar to play poker?
I think so.
Why?
She's like, you bought all this I've said so far.
You bought this. Yeah, so, yeah. But, you know, you do. It's like so many levels of of it's psychology, it's
deception.
I read where you said that poker is a lot like life.
Poker is a lot
so
like life.
So what did you mean by that? How is that?
I mean a lot of things, like, you know, you wow, that's like a whole conversation. What's a good sentence?
Poker's a lot like life.
Poker's a lot like life.
Because?
You know when to hold 'em, you know when to fold 'em.
There you go.
No, you know what? As we're talking, I'll think of really good examples of that.
So let me ask you this. Obviously, or maybe not. Maybe you just get jobs now. Do you still audition for jobs?
Yeah, I still audition.
So when you, and do you audition from home or do you go to your agents?
I audition from home.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
So you have a home studio.
I have a home studio-ish.
Okay.
I just actually built a back house at my house, which is so exciting. And my plan was to put the studio in the back house, but that didn't work out.
Yet. You're going to
have
to make
it
happen.
No, because I was like, wait, do I put like a bedroom area in the back or do I put a studio? And I had to forego. So now I have to figure out where I'm actually going to put the studio. So no, I am like a lot of people. I every day must come out of the closet.
Okay, good.
But into the closet and come out of the closet.
So let me ask you this. So you have a home studio.
Yes.
You still audition from home.
Yes.
So, you know, there's a lot of people out there that actually, you know, live all over the frickin' world, right?
Yeah.
Frickin', I said, by the way. I'm clean. I'm keeping it clean.
Keeping it clean.
And
first time for everything.
And, you know, they're doing the same thing. They're auditioning from home, stuff like that. Do you have any advice that you can give them that maybe you use on your auditions to really deliver a great audition, in your opinion, whether animation or video game?
Well, I mean, this is the beautiful thing about, you know, being able to audition from your closet. For anybody who's auditioning from their closet, is that you can do as many takes as you want to do. Mm-hmm. Where when you go to your agency to audition or you go do an outside audition, you know, I mean, even if they let you do a few takes, you don't always feel great about that, about, you know, what you did. So, I mean, I would say that if you have the opportunity to do that, to have the time to do that, mm-hmm. really take the time to, you know, get something that you're really, really happy with.
Yeah.
If you send it out and you're not happy, that's what they're going to be left with.
Right.
And that, I mean, I feel like with auditions, I mean, you know, the more you do it, the easier it becomes, and you usually can kind of get it in one or two takes. But you can also do a lot of cutting and pasting, and I just, you know, like, don't be shy about spending a lot of time on an audition, especially when casting people don't know you. Mm-hmm. You don't want to send anything that is going to leave them with like a eh. And even at this point in my career, there are tons of auditions that I decide not to send in because I think to myself, I'm like, you know what? I know blah, 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 blah is going to knock that out of the park.
Yeah.
And why leave them with something that's less than what I think is
exactly
perfection?
Yeah. Well, let me ask you, what do you think it is that they really want to hear in that audition, in your opinion?
I think, you know, a lot of people talk about, like, you know, like having a great voice or this or that, and really, truly, if you, any voiceover person that's doing well and has a really long career is going to be someone who has the acting chops behind it. So I think, you know, when you're working on trying to become a voiceover person, that's something that's really good to work on too. Work on your acting chops, your being able to sort of your improv chops, those kind of things. Because I think what casting people are looking for is not just a voice. And sometimes having a great voice, like, the, you know, works for certain things.
Yeah.
And I would say that also works a lot more with commercial voiceover, which also, you know, takes good acting chops, but, you know, a lot of times they're looking for a certain quality in your voice and all those things. But with animation, you just need to be able to come up with a lot of stuff, because if you want to work for years and years and years, there's always going to be new people coming up, and if you don't do a lot of stuff and a lot of different voices, then eventually they're gonna have heard you do the same thing a lot, and maybe it was great, or maybe it was like you were on a hit show and that really worked. But then if you can't do something else, so with that being said, I think that also, you know, casting people love to be able to hire people that can do three voices. on their show, or eight voices on their game, or those things. So working on your range is really, really important. And also, you know, there are plenty of casting people who love outside the box, you know, and something different that isn't just the same old grandma or the same old witch or the same old thing. And sometimes they want classic stuff. And I would just say that, like, you know, having a range of all those things is really, really great, to be able to have the classic stuff in the bag and then also have, you know, an imagination. Mm-hmm. That's really big.
Yeah. So really taking that scenario and bringing it to life.
Yeah, really taking that
scenario. What do you think are your strengths as a performer? What's in your bag of tricks?
I mean, I think that what I just said is my bag of tricks, because I think, like, other, you know, there's some amazing women voiceover people that, you know, I have so much respect for, that, you know, there's probably 10 women that are doing a lot of the jobs, because those 10 women can do a lot of voices. And so I think, you know, that's one of those things, is that I have really tried hard to be able to do the kid voice stuff and the, you know, like, I do a lot of urban stuff, and I do a lot, you know, for video games and all that kind of stuff.
What's
so
urban stuff?
Urban is, like, I do, you know, a lot of, you know, like, Hispanic chicks and, like, chicks from the street,
do you
and,
speak
like,
Spanish
army
at
chicks
all,
and badly.
Badly?
Mm-hmm.
And,
can
we,
you
hear
know,
a little bit of your urban, like, an urban character?
Well, I mean, you know, it's just like, because, like, I remember one of the first, I remember one of the first things I did, like, back in the day, because I had moved from New York, and I remember one of the first things I did was working on, what was that movie, Road to El Dorado, DreamWorks, and they were looking, because Rosie Perez was doing everything, but I was like, this is very funny, because, like, all the chicks that I grew up with, and with the subway with, and everybody sounds like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it was like, for me, I was like, Rosie got out here, and I mean, no knocking Rosie, love her, but I'm just saying, I was like, hey, that's, you know, so I started thinking of all those sort of, like, different versions of that and stuff. And so I remember one of the first jobs I had was, you know, scratching her stuff for Road to El Dorado, you know, and blah, blah, blah. So, and then, you know, I end up doing a lot of, like, you know, both. Chicks for,
tough
you know,
chicks.
Like tough chicks.
Tough chicks.
Tough chicks. There's a family of tough broads.
She's doing tough,
you know,
chicks.
Tough chicks. And, you know, and then you have to have your, like, you know, evil chicks.
Evil chicks.
And then you got your sexy chicks.
Right.
And then you got your
and
sexy
then you got
chicks.
Your sexy evil chicks.
We will,
sexy evil chicks. Whoa,
we will
there's
be,
so many chicks.
We will get bad, bad emails if we don't talk about some of your characters. And there are so many. So we, you know, won't keep you here all night. But obviously, someone who you're currently playing, Luna, in The Loud House.
Yeah.
Such a fun show.
Oh, it's such a fun show.
Such a great cast, and Greg Griffin,
Chad
Tabor, and Larjo Miller, such a great cast.
Amazing.
So how did that all come about, Loud House and Luna?
That
where
was
did
like
she
what I,
from?
Well, she can't, so that was just another awesome score, you know? I mean, so, Chris Savino created this show about this, you know, young kid. I'm just saying this for anybody who hasn't seen it, because it's like this almost like old school, awesome, beautiful show about this, you know, young kid boy who's got 10 sisters. And so, you know, they had this audition where they came in, they're like, okay, I can't remember what it was, but they basically like, do some voices for sisters, like what you'd think. And I think I was the first person to go in there. So I was kind of bummed, because when I left, I thought, oh, I had all these other ideas that I wanted to do.
Yeah.
But I guess one of the ones that they were left with was this sort of like rocker chick sister.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. And she's so fine. That's the sister I ended up getting, Luna.
What does she sound like?
She sort of sounds like me, but she's got this kind of, you know, raspy, but she's also, you know, but she's real spunky, and she's like, yeah, bro, everything's bro, and everything's like, you know, she's like, dude, every other word is like, dude, you know,
that's
and,
cool.
You know, she's,
I like that.
And she's always singing and playing her guitar, and,
oh,
you know, and
great.
She's, and she's kind of, you know, kind of a space cadet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, but all she cares about is rocking.
She's like the kid version of you.
Yeah.
Well, no, so
did
what
you
I
play
think...
poker too? Or?
No, not yet. Or at least we don't know about it yet.
Next season.
Yeah.
Take it on the road. And then, but what I think is so wonderful about you, many things, but is obviously your range. And then you go to like Ventress in Star Wars, The Clone Wars.
Yeah.
I mean, first of all, the vocal quality, it's so beautiful. I mean, it's just like this warm, buttery gravy. I mean, just the sound of her is, and what I find so interesting, especially with darker characters, is how you've given her so many levels. She's not just mean. You've really, how do you, was that, I mean, obviously the characters evolve over time, but how is it, because you do play some of the darker stuff, so how do you find more than just the, you know, the heart, if you will, of a dark?
Well, I loved playing her, and it was sad when Clone Wars ended, because we were actually about to go into this whole other world of who she was becoming, which was going to be so cool. And then the ripcord, just ripped out of, never
we're
mind.
Not good.
Never mind.
Good.
No,
she lives on greatly in me.
Yeah, and she, and I would definitely say that she's definitely, and it's interesting, because she wasn't even, you know, a lead in Clone Wars. I mean, she was... I didn't get to sort of delve in even nearly as much as I wanted to, but it was just so cool because, you know, she started off and you kind of sort of think she's one thing, and then the story evolved into making her these many layers of, like, human who, you know, you find out that she sort of came from this sort of terrible past, and so I started off with just this kind of, you know, idea in my head that she was, I keep trying to think of ways to say things without saying words like kick a,
kick ass?
Can I say that? Oh, I didn't know.
First of all, let me tell you something.
Okay.
You can say anything you want to say.
Okay, cool. And then you'll just beat
you're
me
You're a grown up.
You'll just beat me.
Yeah, you're a grown up.
Okay, I didn't know if, like,
if somebody gets offended, they could turn on CBS.
Because it's been really, really hard for me not to swear because I'm a big cursor. I curse a lot.
The interwebs.
The interwebs, yeah. No, she was just, like, she's this, like, kick-ass chick that, like, for me, the first thing I thought about was, like, you know, the psychology of this person who had this terrible thing, and everyone's left her, and everyone's died in her life, and all she wants to do is, like, sort of, like, kick-ass, and she's sort of lost because, you know, when you don't have your mommy and daddy anymore, you end up with the bad guys, and then they betray you, and then you have to reevaluate, and then you go back to sort of your family with the Night Sisters, and so it was this, like, whole process, and just getting the part in the first place was, like, you know... tough, and I was so happy when they let me have it. And
it's like FBI clearance.
Yeah, it's like FBI clearance. No, seriously, every time that you get a script and everything, you have to sign it. You had to sign your life away. It's like I didn't realize the world of which Star Wars is just this incredible, just incredible. It's beyond anything like I could have ever imagined.
Yeah.
The fans, the just the mythology of the whole thing. So I was like, this is awesome. But like I said, there are plenty of other people who are in the world who know a lot more about it. And I just sort of, the only way, because I wasn't someone who was heavy, heavy into knowing what was going on in the Star Wars universe, I just kind of made her what I thought was human.
Yeah.
That was a sort of a long-winded... Yeah. Answer to your question.
No, it's great.
We'll edit it down to about three words and you'll be fine.
Wait, hold on. Yeah. I just want to, because I have to, I love bragging about people.
Yeah.
So, of course, Chum Chum in Fanboy and Chum Chum.
Yeah.
Adorable.
Yeah. He was super cute.
So cute. Of course, we talked about Ventress. Styx in Sonic Boom.
Yeah. See, there are some, that's, Styx is an interesting character because she's this badger, you know, who, it was kind of like, oh, what's his name? John
Leguizamo.
I can never say his last name, and I love him with all my heart. And you know how his character in Ice Age.
Here's
all of a sudden there's this animal, and he's got New York accent, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I was like, if he can do it, why can't I do it?
Totally.
She's adorable.
Except that I've had a few characters over my lifespan where I threw in the New York thing because I was like, come on, people.
Listen, yeah. I'm from New York too.
Right?
I'm proud of
right?
it.
Right? And so it I was fits. Like, she was, Swagger. So she's supposed to be, what I love about her is she's this complete paranoid, delusional character. And what's awesome is like she's like everybody else is like sort of like the straight guy, and mm-hmm. she and like so I get to be the funny freaky, which, you know, I know that some people probably find her incredibly annoying, and I get that. But she's so much fun.
Oh, I think she's adorable.
To play, and she's like, I got all these voices in my head. I caught it. He said it's done. Stick a fork in it.
Well, now I feel like I want to go gambling or something and play some cards.
We have to brush up.
I know, right? That was part one with Nika Futterman. We're going to be back next week with part two. Hope you're here with us.
Yes, we will. And don't forget to check out Debbie Derryberry's book, Voiceover 101, How to Succeed as a Voice Actor. And guess what? You can check us out on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and subscribe to our YouTube channel.
Hold on. Let me say that one more time. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. Click up there somewhere.
We really feel strongly about this, please, for Chuck's sake. Okay, you guys, we love you. Thank you so much for watching. And just remember, you always have time for a little buzz. Come on, come on, come on
and get buzzed with us. The O-Buzz Weekly is sponsored by Chuck Duran's Demos That Rock. The voiceover demo producer to the stars is now available to you. Visit demos.rock.com and take your voiceover career to the next level. See you next time. And remember, you always have time for a little buzz.